Sometime around 2006, the United States and Israel launched a joint cyber operation attacking the Iranian nuclear enrichment facility at Natanz. The operation would last more than 4 years until the worm was accidentally released into the wild and discovered by cybersecurity experts. I'm Noah Zerbe, professor of politics and international studies at Humboldt State University, and this is the story of Operation Olympic Games, the world's first cyber attack impacting the physical world. In 2006, President George W. Bush ordered the launch of Operation Olympic Games, a covert cyber operation intended to undermine Iran's nuclear enrichment program. When Barack Obama was elected president, Bush met with him and stressed the importance of Olympic Games. Not only did Obama continue the operation, he expanded it. Though never officially acknowledged, it's now widely believed that Operation Olympic Games was a joint effort of the American National Security Agency and Israelis Unit 8200, a covert cyber operations unit. The operation centered on an effort to introduce malicious code into computer control systems at the Iranian nuclear enrichment plant at Natanz. The facility was home to thousands of nuclear centrifuges capable of enriching uranium to weapons-grade quality. The facility was protected by anti-aircraft sites, and the processing facility itself was buried deep underground and protected by hardened concrete structures. The goal of Operation Olympic Games was twofold. First, the United States hoped that they could slow down Iran's nuclear development program and force the Iranian government back to the negotiating table. And second, the United States hoped the program would dissuade Israel from launching unilateral airstrikes against Iranian nuclear facilities, strikes the United States believe could destabilize the region and possibly expand into a regional war. The plan itself was ingenious. American and Israeli computer coders would create a program that would target the sensitive centrifuges used to enrich nuclear material, ultimately destroying the centrifuges themselves. The program would also disguise its work, seemingly striking at random intervals and presenting as though the centrifuges were functioning normally. The program, which came to be known as the Stuxnet Worm, was incredibly successful. Once slipped into the Iranian facility, most likely by an infected USB drive as the facility was air-gapped from the internet, the program buried itself in the network, ultimately coming into operation and destroying about 1,000 of the 5,000 centrifuges at the Natanz facility, and ultimately forcing the facility to be taken offline completely. But in the summer of 2010, the Stuxnet worm escaped the Iranian facility and spread to computers around the world. The worm drew the attention of coders. It was far larger than the average piece of code, but contained no bugs, a feature that's pretty rare in malware. It was also partially autonomous, using a zero-day exploit to spread without human intervention. And it was clearly designed to target a very specific and uncommon piece of machinery, an industrial controller made by Siemens to control specialty pumps, and it contained an expiration date. The worm essentially worked to destabilize the Iranian centrifuges. Those centrifuges work at supersonic speeds. Any dramatic change, say one triggered by changes in electric current set by the Siemens control panel, could force the centrifuges to spin out of balance, making them unstable and ultimately even exploding, taking the centrifuge offline and often destroying other machinery nearby, as well as perhaps even leaking uranium gas into the facility. Ultimately, however, the attack itself only had a limited impact on Iran's nuclear program. It forced Iran to delay some of its enrichment facilities, but it also created the window within which the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action was negotiated. But it also encouraged Iran to expand its enrichment capabilities, hiding them in more secure and harder to access facilities. But even if the physical impact of the attack itself was limited, the symbolic impact of the Stuxnet attack was massive. Stuxnet marked the first time a cyber attack was used to destroy physical infrastructure in the real world. It was the first formal offensive cyber sabotage by the United States against another country. And it gave justification for other countries to engage in similar activities. The symbolic importance of the attack was not lost on actors at the time. According to David Sanger of the New York Times, President Obama worried about the attack setting a precedent that would legitimate the use of cyber weapons in the future, and in a sense, that's exactly what happened. General Michael Hayden, who served as the director of both the National Security Agency and the Central Intelligence Agency, was equally candid in his assessment. According to Hayden, the Stuxnet attack has a whiff of August 1945, a reference to the US nuclear bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Somebody just used a new weapon, and this weapon will not be put back in the box. Later, Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta would warn about the possibility of a cyber Pearl Harbor, an attack that would cause physical destruction and loss of life, an attack that would paralyze and shock the nation and create a profound new sense of vulnerability, all without firing a bullet or dropping a bomb. Panetta insisted an aggressor nation or extremist group could use these kinds of cyber tools to gain control of critical switches. They could derail passenger trains, or even more dangerous, derail passenger trains loaded with lethal chemicals. They could contaminate the water supply of major cities or shut down power grids across large parts of the country. That's not to say that there weren't other cyber operations before Olympic Games. Indeed, there were many, not just by the United States, but by other key cyber actors as well. Russia had successfully hacked into the US military intelligence networks, including a two-year operation called Operation Moonlight Maze, which captured thousands of pages of unclassified material on sensitive military technologies. China had been even more successful in its efforts, stealing classified information from the defense contractor Lockheed Martin on the F-35 program. But what made Olympic Games unusual was that it was not simply a hacking effort to gather intelligence. It was a physical attack, destroying sensitive, real-world infrastructure. And this got policymakers thinking about the role and nature of cyber operations more generally. We'll consider the nature and implications of cyber espionage, cyber attacks, and cyber warfare in the context of international law in another video. That's it for now. Please leave any questions you have in the comments section below, and thanks for watching. Have a good day, everyone. Bye.